we cannot really say anything. If you just look at the system of linear equations, we cannot say whether there are solutions, there's a unique solution, infinity of solution. Cannot say any of those things without actually solving it, which is not ideal. We want to have some way of doing this, especially we want to be able to use a computer to do this. So we need some kind of an algorithm to determine these things fast. And that algorithm is called Gaussian elimination. So as you know, a system of linear equations can be written as a matrix equation. And on the matrix, we can define certain operations called the elementary row operations, which will transform the matrix without changing the solutions or the solvability conditions. So this is what it is. If you have m equations and n unknowns, what you will do is to create a matrix A that's got m rows, as many rows as equations, and as many columns as the unknowns. And then you will write x, which is your unknowns, so x, y, z, or x1, x2, x3, etc., equal to a constant. Ax equal to b. A is just numbers. B is just numbers. And x is a vector of unknowns. The matrix A comes from the coefficients of the equations. Each equation is of the form some number times x plus some number times y. Those numbers are called coefficients. And A is a collection of those coefficients in the right place. And B will be the right-hand side of the equations. And that would be just constants. So remember, our equations are always in the form expression equal to constant. Now, since A and B are just numbers now, you can think of feeding them into a computer and then doing manipulations on the numbers and getting a computer to tell you more about the solvability of the equations and maybe even solve the equations for you. So let me define the elementary row operations that we will be performing. As you know, each row in Ax equal to b is an equation. What can we do with equations when you're trying to solve them? You can add or subtract any of the equations. You can scale an equation by any number. So you multiply the left-hand side and right-hand side by some number. The equation is still valid. So for instance, if I have these two equations, I can subtract the first equation from the second one and minus y, I get minus 2y, and then I can get y. So that's one way of solving it. Now, corresponding to these operations, the algebraic manipulations that you can do on equations, you can define row operations on the matrix, on the coefficient and constant matrix. So you can swap any two rows. You can multiply a row by a scalar. That will still be a valid equation. You can add a multiple of a row to another row. Now, in our algorithm, Gaussian elimination, we will not be using the second elementary row operation. So that's why that is in gray. So the important point is that by doing any one of these elementary row operations or a multiple of them, the solutions are not changed and the solvability conditions are not changed. And also, if you just do the third operation, not the first one or the second one, and if the coefficient matrix A happens to be a square matrix, then you have a determinant and the determinant doesn't change. Add a multiple of a row to another row, the determinant doesn't change. So let's take our equations and cast them in the matrix form. So our equation was x plus y equal to 5. So 1 times x plus 1 times y equal to 5. X minus y, 1 times x minus 1 times y is equal to 1. So those are the two equations written in the matrix form. Now I'm going to do EROs, elementary row operations on these. Obviously, whatever I do on the left-hand side, I have to do on the constants part also. Whatever I do to these guys, I have to do the same things to these guys also. For that reason, we can create something called the augmented matrix. We'll just put 5 and 1 along with A and call it a different matrix, augmented matrix. That's my equation in matrix form. So that's my equation in the raw form. And I create an augmented matrix, which I write having the coefficient part here and a bar here and then the constants part here. The bar is optional. It's only for visualization purpose. So that then you will do some elementary row operation. Here, what I'll do is to subtract the first row from the second row so that I kill the second row first element, and that's all I want to do with this simple matrix. If I had one more row, I would subtract some scale version of the first row from the third row also, so that element also is zero. I will basically kill the first elements of all the rows below the first row using the first row by scaling the first row and then subtracting or adding. Similarly, in the next step, I will use the second row. It's already got the first element zero. Then I'll use the second element and kill all the elements below that. That's my plan. what is left, the first non-zero element that is left in each row is called the pivot. And this form is called the row echelon form. And then I'm going to define one more concept, the rank of a matrix, which is the number of pivots. So here I have two pivots in blue. So the number of pivots is 2, and that is the rank of the matrix. So what I want is this. All rows with zero elements, if there are such rows, will have to be at the bottom of the matrix. And in each row, first non-zero element in any row is strictly to the right of the first non-zero element in the row above it. Which means if I have one column some number that is non-zero, in the second row, I cannot have a non-zero element in the first column. So this is one example where I have pivots. This also should have been in red. So that is one pivot. There's a second pivot, two pivots, and the rank is 2. And the second row has the first non-zero element, which is called the pivot, to the right of the non-zero element in the first row. This satisfies the second rule. So this is in REF, row echelon form. It's called row echelon because in French, echelon means stairs or steps. So this is like steps. This is another example where I have a 4x4 matrix, 4 pivots. Okay, so it is in row echelon form. How about this guy? It also does. It's just that in the second column, I don't have a pivot. The pivot happens to be in the third column. Here, how about this guy? This also is in row echelon form. Steps here. The last example there. This also is in row echelon form. It has a row of zeros. The row of zeros is in the bottom, so it satisfies the first condition and satisfies the second condition too. If I swap these two, then obviously that won't be in the row echelon form. Let me define the pivots and ranks once more. The leading non-zero element in a row of a matrix in its row echelon form, that is the pivot. It's also called the leading coefficient for obvious reasons. So any column that has a pivot is called a pivot column. If there is a column without a pivot, that is a non-pivot column. So all rows are either pivot rows or zero rows. The rank is the number of pivots in a matrix in its REF. That is the definition of rank now. Rank of A, if you have m rows and n columns, the best you can have is a pivot in each column. And obviously, you cannot have more pivots than the rows either, because each row will have only as a leading non-zero element, or it's all zero. You cannot have more than the minimum of number of rows and number of columns as the rank. If a rank of a matrix is the minimum of the number of rows and columns, it is a full rank matrix. If it is not, then the rank is deficient, and the rank deficiency is the maximum possible rank it can have minus the actual rank it does have. All right, now let's talk about Gaussian elimination. It's also known as a row reduction. It is an algorithm to reduce a matrix, a coefficient matrix, to its row echelon form using the three operations that we specified. So the three operations are these three. But we're not going to use the second one here. So this guy is not used. And even this one, the swapping of two rows, we'll do it only when we have to. So the third one is where the game is, adding a multiple of any row to another. But you know that that doesn't change the determinant. And the solution is unchanged because the row operations are just algebraic manipulations of the equations. The row reduction or the Gaussian elimination is usually done on the augmented matrix because you're trying to solve the equations. All right, so let's look at the algorithm here. Use the first row of the first equation to kill the first element in each row. So that is possible if the first element in the first row has a non-zero element. You can always take scale versions of that and subtract it from the rows below and kill the first elements in all the rows below. That is always possible. If it is not possible, which means the first element in the first equation is not non-zero, it is actually zero, then you cannot scale it and subtract and hope to kill any other element. So at that point, you will have to swap two rows. After doing that, you take the second row and use its pivot leading coefficient, which is the pivot. Use that to kill all the rows below that, and so on. You just do that, and you can actually write it up as an algorithm. You will see that what you're doing is, in the second step, you have a slightly smaller matrix than the first one, one fewer columns and one fewer rows, and then use the same iteratively until you run out of rows and columns. So the result will be an upper triangular matrix, which is the row echelon form of A, or the augmented matrix. Once we have the row echelon form, then we can start talking about the solvability. Now, looking at the REF, let's look at the solvability. So the statement is here. So if the REF of the augmented matrix has a zero row, a row of zeros, on the A side, which is the coefficient side, equaling to a non-zero on the constant side, on the B side, that's when we have inconsistency. That's how you detect inconsistency. The moment you have inconsistency, you know that there are no solutions. So you just stop at that point. So you give up. No point continuing or trying to solve anymore. If not, if you have no such rows of zeros equating non-zeros, then you do have solutions. Then you can look at the number of pivots, which is the rank of the REF. If it is equal to the number of variables, that means you have just the right number of consistent and independent equations, then you have a unique solution. If not, you'll have an infinity of solutions. And there is no situation where you have the number of pivots greater than the number of variables, because that means the number of pivots more than the number of columns. That can never happen. I stated this without actually telling you why it is true. So let's take a look at the examples, then you will see why this comes about. I start with a consistent independent set of equations. I do the augmented matrix. I find REF, and it doesn't have a zero equal to non-zero row. That means it's solvable. I have two pivots here. So rank is 2, number of unknowns is 2. So I have a unique solution. The second situation, I had only one equation. So I have my augmented matrix like this. There's no row below, so this is already in the REF. Obviously, it doesn't have 0 equal to non-zero kind of row, so it is solvable. There's only one pivot, but I have two unknowns. So the rank is less than the number of variables, so I have infinity of solutions. The third situation, two equations. How do I get rid of the second row first column element? I want to get rid of this guy, so I scale the first row by 2 and subtract from the second row. So that becomes 0, but then this also becomes 0, and that also becomes 0. I have a 0 row, but 0 is not equal to non-zero. There is no inconsistency. The system is still consistent. But what's the rank now? Only one pivot and two unknowns still, so infinity of solutions. Okay, rank is less than the number of variables, infinity of solutions. Next example here, this is the inconsistent situation. Again, I want to get rid of this one here, so I just subtract the first row from the second, so this goes away, so I get zero there. The second guy also goes away, I get zero there. The augmented side, the constant side, I get 6 minus 5, I get 1. So I do have 0 equal to non-zero. So that points to inconsistency. That's how it comes about. That means this is not solvable. I don't worry about the rank or anything. Now, if you have three equations, again, I want to get rid of this guy, so I subtract the first one from the second, so I get a minus 2. I want to get rid of this guy, so I subtract 3 times that from this guy, so I get 0 here. Or what do I get here? Minus 1 minus 3, so I have actually have minus 4 here. And 3 times 5, 7 minus 15, so I have minus 8 here. That's what I have after the first row operation. Then I use minus 2 here to get rid of minus 4, so I multiply by 2 and subtract from here, so that becomes 0. Multiply by 2 here, so I get minus 8. Subtract from minus 8, I get 0 there also. So I see that I have no inconsistency because I have no 0 equal to non-zero there. So it is solvable. The rank is one pivot plus another pivot, so 2. Rank is 2, which is the same as the number of variables. So I have a unique solution. I play the same game here. Now what I get in the last row is a 0 equal to non-zero. That means inconsistency, not solvable. So the complexity in the system of linear equations can be kind of assessed and understood once you get the REF, which is the result of Gaussian elimination. If the row echelon form of the augmented matrix has a zero of rows on the coefficient side, A side, equaling to a non-zero on the B side, the constant side, then we have inconsistency, no solutions, we give up. Otherwise, we look at the number of pivots in the row echelon form, which is the rank of the matrix, of the augmented matrix. If it is the same as the number of variables, then we have just enough equations to solve perfectly, you have a unique solution. And if the number of pivots is smaller than the number of variables, then you have an infinity of solutions. And the number of pivots can never be greater than the number of variables because the number of variables is the same as the number of columns.